so or more, were the theaters doing events and trying to think about this 50 years of making cheap art and political theater. On the far left is Tom Finkelpearl, who is the director of the Queens Museum of Art, executive director, and before that was deputy director at PS1, and he has a number of books coming out that have come out. He has a new book coming out about cooperative art, I think. And the Queens Museum of Art is going to host an exhibition of Peter Schumann's work in the fall of 2013, which is being curated by Jonathan Berger. And it's in the new Queens Museum of Art space. And of course, this is Peter Schumann to my left. We wanted to, well, personally, I'm interested in this as a sort of quasi-theater historian, in part because when I was a member of the theater, I started to write pieces in academic journals about Bread and Puppet, and I sort of wanted other people to do that, and that hasn't happened so much. So I'm hoping that other people will do that, because it's interesting to think about what this theater has been doing in the past 50 years or so, and what the theater's doing right now. And I was super interested in Dead Man Rises and also The Possibilitarians. And we wanted to talk about both of those shows, I believe, and bringing together our different perspectives and Tom's thinking about the nature of art that's created in a cooperative fashion. I was reading up on Stefan Brecht's great, cool book about Bread and Puppet Theater, and Dead Man Rises was created in 1967, I think he says. I might have that wrong. And I appreciated that Peter mentioned this this connection with Bob Nichols and thinking of No Theater. Around the time of a lot of demonstrations that Bread and Puppet was taking part in, and very political shows like A Man Says Goodbye to His Mother, which is a street show made around the same time. But as you've seen, Dead Man Rises is very different. And Stefan has a whole interesting theory about the nature of the mass political demonstrations of the time, the changing nature of the peace movement, the arrival of the diggers, and the creation of the Yippies in 1967. And I know Peter, talking with Peter, there's a very interesting environment in New York City, the theaters in New York. Dead Man Rises was performed at Astor Place Theater, now the Public Theater, every Saturday for a number of months in 67, 68. Mm-hmm. And Peter's talked about other interesting groups like the Up Against the Wall Motherfuckers and other political groups in New York that were part of this developing creation of political art in the city. In 1968, of course, students at Columbia University who were upset about building a gymnasium in Harlem protested and took over the school. And there was, so in other words, they occupied the university. So this is a big moment in 60s political activism, the student occupation of Columbia University in 68. And one of the things that happened is that the students invited Bread and Puppet, which by this time had been in the streets and making political theater since 63, I think, is when Grace Paley and the Greenwich Village Peace Center invited the theater to take part in demonstrations. Bread and Puppet had been taking part in political demonstrations and making political theater, mostly about the war in Vietnam. And the students invited Bread and Puppet to do a show in the occupied university. And the show that you chose to do was Dead Man Rises, which was, does not, at first glance, appear to be the obvious, agitprop choice that one might want to make. So I wanted to ask you to why you did that show, why you chose to do that show at the for the occupied university, occupied Columbia University, back in 68.
We were fully aware that the students expected the opposite of that. Rather, how a man gets killed in a how a man gets brought back to life in a fairy tale fashion. But I think we wanted to do the opposite of what they expected. And we didn't want to do the logical thing. And the play is also not just this play, it comes out of a whole row of plays that we did during those years that didn't have politics in them. They had another element in them that should be properly called sculpted show, sculpted time, time that gets sculpted and treated like sculpture and forces people to some quantity of stillness and of concentration that usually is absent in this culture or in people's education. And this sculpting of shows that were not attractive and didn't try to be attractive in any way, there was an issue that went on, I think, right from the beginning of Bottom Puppet. I cannot remember all the titles of these shows, because many of them were only performed one time, probably for good reasons. But also, there were too many of them. But I remember some of them. Leaf Feeling the Moonlight was like this, or Fire certainly was like this. Fire was a show about the war. But it was, it had no language in it. It was entirely still hardly any sound in it. And it wasn't directly learned from No either, from the No place. I knew Yeats, his chamber works pretty well, but my family was friends with the German translator of the Yeats place. So I knew him as a kid already. I greatly admired Yeats, and I knew that his chamber plays were very much influenced by the Ghost plays in the No Cycle. And then when I met Bob Nichols here, who had an active interest in making the most use of the visit of the No Master, and also was researching one particular play called The Birds of Sorrow, it's one of the most beautiful ones, and the Keoghan for it is called Birdcatcher in Hell. And then Bob Nichols wrote The Birdcatcher in Hell about a, I think that was in 63, about a helicopter pilot. At that time, America was totally disguising its war activities under the pretense that this was all advisory capacities. So this play was about a helicopter pilot, an American in Vietnam, and written by Bob Nichols. And we performed it in our loft on Delancey Street. And then I performed, following his play, the original Keoghan, all in blue. Now it's all red.
And when you did think Dead Man Rises, I don't know if this memory would be fresh in any way, but what I wondered what it was, what kind of reaction the students at Columbia might have had to that play. Were they expecting Man Says Goodbye, or was this part of the cultural moment where people were like ready for this, or was it more?
No, I don't think people were ready for it. I think we just wanted to be audacious, and we were audacious. And the students didn't know what to do with it. And some probably did, and others didn't. But I do not remember a specific reaction. It was neither cheering it on nor booing it. It was just sitting there. That's what I remember.
And for you, did this represent a kind of a conflict in a way, like in terms of the when I read the stuff on Brecht's book, you know, you're caught up in that sort of roiling environment of the mid '60s, when there's so many demonstrations and like the Yippie attempt to levitate the Pentagon, with Bread and Puppet played at the beginning of that a demonstration in front of the Lincoln Memorial, I think, on the reflecting pool, which I just want to notice is really well documented in the Chris Marker film, The Sixième Face du Pentagon, The Sixth Face of the Pentagon, which is a really great film about this, which includes footage of Bread and Puppet. Chris Marker, who is an admirer of the work. And so that's all going on. There's all this political stuff going on. Did shows like Dead Man Rises or the other sort of not political shows seem to you a conflict, or were you doing those because you didn't want to do the political shows, or were they all part of the same type of work?
It's hard to answer that question because we also, obviously being the public theater, we also did kids shows, we did seasonal shows a lot, we did Christmas stories, we did Thanksgiving celebration shows, we played all the Lower East Side churches, schools, all kinds of different activities, and the war stuff was sort of, it was coming over us. We couldn't, it became more and more, finally, I feel we wanted to flee from it. We wanted to run away from it. It was too much, it was all over the place. But also, it had its protesting logic, which we didn't agree with. It had its moments of sort of the elements of handsome church dinner, outside meeting, sandwiching in the street, and then carrying posters of burned napalm children, which to us didn't work to do that. And so we were always not only doing these things, but we also were in opposition to them, a lot, I remember that. A lot of trouble, always trying to persuade Grace. She was a very good communicator with people. And so, for example, she was excellent with cops. And most of the cops in the village, she knew all their mamas. So she had an easy way of doing something with them. But she was, I think, of the same mind, that this picnic atmosphere of the big Fifth Avenue peace marches and so on was disgusting to us. We wanted to do something where people were forced to not do that. So when you're inside the Grey Lady puppet in 7 foot of clothes and you have to shut up and you are being shut up and you can only move slow and you're being organized in the choreography that consists of so much material that you have to take care of. You have no time to gossip, you have no time to sandwich or to drink your beloved soft drinks or whatever it is. So you're just in there and you suffer for a little while and then you did it. So that was the hard thing to bring across, I think. Sorry for that.
Can I ask a couple of questions about the Diggers?
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, there's the historical Diggers who were the folks who were planting on the commons. And then there was the Diggers who were the offshoot of the San Francisco mine group.
Right.
So, I mean, are you in this Diggers referring, I mean, primarily to the historical Diggers?
Right, yeah. The texts are from the historical Diggers.
From the historical Diggers. Yeah. But is there any relationship with those 60s Diggers?
Well, one of the Diggers joined us, became a puppeteer. George Conniff, he was a digger in San Francisco, and then knocked at our door at the courthouse here on Second Street and said, "Hey, can I go on tour with you?"
So there was a digger in-house.
A digger in-house. Yeah.
So then, as I understand it, the Yippies were, you know, an offshoot of the Diggers, and they wanted to actually call it the New York Diggers, but the Diggers from San Francisco said, "No, we don't want to be that overtly political." And Abby Hoffman and Jerry Rubin, who had had a kind of background in SNCC, you know, in terms of organizing in the South, wanted to be really directly political, like the action of the New York Stock Exchange. And I just wondered if you were embroiled at all in those kind of you know, because there's this anarchist strain in the Diggers, which I think you might be sympathetic with. But there's a political strain in the hippies you also might be sympathetic with. And so how about that?
But there is a lot of overlap. I mean, Abby Hoffman and Diggers, and also Vera Williams and Grace, I believe we all went to New Jersey when the riots happened. And we did them, but we did very different things. Vera Williams did food, soup distribution. Mm. We did puppet shows. Abby Hoffman did lollipop distribution. So everybody had different idea whether to sweeten people or to sour them. Or get them over the head with a puppet.
And then, I mean, I think it's also the Diggers. The San Francisco Diggers had it. The food was an extremely important part of their practice, right?
Yeah.
As it is with yours. Yeah. Obviously, the Yippies were less food-oriented. But I just wanted to, you know, the puppet gets talked about more than the bread and puppet. But I just wondered if the bread was part of the deal back then, like, let's say, with the performance at the occupied Columbia building, or is that already part of it?
Well, the bread is obviously that idea, that same idea that the Diggers, or now the occupiers, have of free food accessibility, distribution, how to do that, and all that. Yeah, you bake a lot of bread, you see it all the time. So it's the same idea, the execution of which is almost totally different, because the Diggers were organizers of how to get free foods and then distribute it. We don't spend that time on that organization. We do it simply by making it and then giving it up at those occasions of shows. So it's similar and not so similar.
But thinking of the Occupy movement now and the Diggers reclaiming the common space in England back in the 17th century, this is about taking space or doing things in particular spaces. And in terms of theater, you know, in the New York theater movement or the 60s theater movement, the spaces are changing because people are working at Judson Church, where you were working in the 60s, and in lofts, some of that's happening, and storefronts. But the overlap between the theatrical work that you're doing, or Bread and Puppet's doing, and the activists are doing, like the Diggers, taking in San Francisco, distributing food in the parks, or demonstrations taking over different places. You mentioned the Wall Street, the Stock Exchange. This is about reclaiming public space or redefining public space as a place for political expression or for theater or art or music. It seems to me that's the link. And I guess a question. Well, it's not so much a question, but the Occupy movement here in New York, where it started, you know, was very much about space. Occupying space was the primary issue, which I think was different from the use of space or the occupation of public space back in the day, 50 years ago, or not less than 50 years ago. So. That's not a question, is it?
He was speaking, you know, he started the Honk Festival in Boston together with Trudy and other people. So that's exactly the same thing. It's the claiming of public space for activities of art and of political exclamation and whatever. It's, you know, very much in line with that. Now, you know, the interesting difference, I think, can be said in a different way also. This here, which used to be a market, is now an educated place. It's a place with expectancy. And
Theater for the New City?
Yeah. But when we did theater, we didn't go, I don't remember playing much in theaters. I think when we did tours, it was by looking for places and this looking for places was connected to what you perform. So for example, we did a big tour of GI coffee houses. There was these GI coffee houses, they are strewn all over the Carolinas and Virginia and I think Maryland. And we did the whole tour of those, and I think this play, Deadman Rising, was performed in GI coffee houses. So and those were spaces that were meant to be GIs protesting the GI situation, you know, just that. That wasn't about a political program with a real purpose in mind. But it was excellent to bring people together in these coffee houses and then perform something crazy like this today, instead of something that would be easier to eat.
Maybe we should open to the public, to their questions, but I had one other. I don't know if this will end up being a question either, but in Rockaway right now, which is a complete disaster area.
And that's near your museum, right?
No, it's in the same borough.
Same borough.
But it's not quite near the museum. It's in Queens. So there's this service tent there. And then there's this idea, there's this question of what can art do in relationship to this kind of mega disaster? And and that sort of was the question with the Vietnam War and the question with the movement and the 60s had to do with, you know, the role of art in relationship to upheaval, or in this case, natural slash of social upheaval. And so one of the things that could be interesting is this idea of not doing the political thing in the midst of that. So let's say in the service tent, Patti Smith, you know, a couple of weeks ago just gave a concert, which wasn't a concert about environmental issues, it was a concert. So giving this performance to the occupiers of the administration building at Columbia, which, I mean, I was a kid at that time, but that took on this huge, you know, national profile, right? Everybody was talking about this occupation. And I just think that is so, it's kind of this admirable twist to not just get in there and say, you guys are doing a great job fighting the man, but let's, you know, there's also sort of the poetry of your artistic creation. I think how do I say, the power of that sort of poetic gesture within that political context shouldn't be denied. Also that, you know, as an artist, you should be able to, you know, not just speak politics in a political situation.
So the place politicizes the play.
No, but the space of imagination shouldn't end at the, you know, at the edge of the occupied environment. That, I don't know if I'm expressing this properly, but I just think that the doing the unexpected is, you know, or sort of working against the sort of structures is something you do anyway, always. And so to do the unexpected within that administration building in Columbia would be the thing as an artist.
Or the, I think of like the, it's this larger and sort of dumb question about the nature of political art, because sometimes the politics of the art is not in the content, but in the form, or in this case, the location. Like Patti Smith singing in the tent there is already doing something that whatever she's singing about, it doesn't matter in a way. But that's becomes a political performance. And likewise, this performance that we've been speaking about of Dead Man Rises at Occupy Columbia University becomes a political performance, even though the story is not at all directly connected to what people were thinking about at that time, which was why they were doing the occupation and the Vietnam War, I think. So that seems to me to expand the idea of what political art is, because I think a lot of times in my experience we tend to think of political art as the content above all.
Mm-hmm. But what is art not political?
Good question.
Depends on how you define political.
No, but it's a bit of just as is.
But then if you say all art is political all the time, then it loses meaning.
Yes, that's right.
On the other hand, it is, whether it likes it or not, even by abstinence, even by conformity, those are still political position takings, you know, to conform, to do the status quo, to represent things as they wish to be represented. It's indeed political. It's a choice. You could do otherwise.
I once had the great pleasure of interviewing Paulo Freire, the great Brazilian philosopher, and he said, let us not forget, in the silence of the studio, the artist is still in a social space. Right? So even that, even if you're not showing it in public, you're still in a social space. I agree with that. I basically agree with you, but I would like to disagree.
In a way, I think it's like a point of view. David Mamet, who, when I first came to Plainfield to work with Bread and Puppet Theater, he was working at Goddard College doing plays, and there was this interesting, those were the two main theater influences, was David Mamet and Bread and Puppet. But and the people would work with both of them, which was interesting, some people. Maybe that's just in my mind.
Pablo Vela,
yeah, sure.
Came last night to the show.
Oh, great. But his play that just closed on Broadway is about I think it's called an anarchism or anarchy, but it's a woman who, it's based on the story of 60s radicals who robbed a bank and this woman, da da da. So it's very political, but he doesn't think of it as political theater because he doesn't like political theater. Like for him, that's, and if I'm not misinterpreting his meaning, and I don't think I am, you know, that's not what art does. So for me, that's an entirely political play, but he doesn't see it that way at all. So it seems to me that to a certain extent, it's what your point of view on whether it's political or not.
Should we take a question?
Yeah, of course. Yes.